Hello everyone. Thanks for joining. You heard about treating alopecia areata with JAK inhibitors and you would like to know more? This is the right place to be. Please join me. So just to specify, JAK inhibitors are not biological drugs. So there's sometimes a misunderstanding because we think that everything what is new is biological. Well, this is not the case. And today I will focus on the new small molecules which are not biological drugs. So what are the JAK inhibitors? The genus kinases, they translate what the cytokine wants to tell the cell. And if we inhibit the activity of the genus kinases, then the cytokine will not be able to communicate with the cell and the effect of the cytokine will be inhibited. Well, we know that there are four JAKs, JAK1, JAK2, JAK3, and JAK4. And this image shows how various cytokines interact with the cells via different receptors, which are associated with different combinations of JAKs. And by knowing this, we can conclude the activity of which cytokines will be inhibited by various drugs. So, for example, if we take the example of tofacitinib, we know that tofacitinib is inhibiting mainly JAK3 and JAK1. And by knowing this, we can conclude which cytokines will be inhibited. We also know which cytokines are most important for the pathogenesis of alopecia areata. And by knowing this, we will transfer the knowledge to the level of the JAKs and to the level of JAK inhibitors. There are many promising JAK inhibitors in alopecia areata. None of them is currently approved. And as you see, what is quite interesting is that there are quite good results on different stages of development with JAK inhibitors, which inhibit various JAKs. So I think we are in the process of finding the best molecule to inhibit for best efficacy in alopecia areata. This is an example. This is tofacitinib, which you know, a JAK1 and JAK3 inhibitor, in a patient who was receiving this drug in a psoriasis clinical trial. This patient had psoriasis and alopecia areata, and to the surprise of the investigators, not only has psoriasis improved, but also he had a full regrowth of hair, and this was the beginning of many dermatologists and investigators being interested in the JAK inhibitors and alopecia areata. Tofacitinib was investigated quite extensively in alopecia areata, and it has shown a 50% regrowth in approximately 32 to 67% of patients. So there are patients with full regrowth and some patients who are non-responders. What has drawn attention of many people to tofacitinib and alopecia areata is that if you discontinue treatment, if you appropriately discontinue treatment, then there is a relapse approximately 80 weeks after stopping. However, we have to keep in mind that alopecia areata is a chronic autoimmune disease, and I think that further investigation should go into finding the best maintenance treatment in patients who have achieved regrowth after a course of treatment with a JAK inhibitor. JAK inhibitors, and in this case tofacitinib, has been shown to be even more effective in adolescents compared to adults. This is important because alopecia areata is a disease which very commonly affects children and adolescents. So if we find a drug which is effective and safe for children with alopecia areata, then definitely this will be one of the major breakthroughs in dermatology. Few cases with baricitinib showing efficacy in patients with alopecia areata, but this is too early to say that whether or not this will show higher efficacy in patients with this disease, and there are many clinical trials which are currently ongoing. So alopecia areata and JAK inhibitors, there's a recent meta-analysis which shows that the response rate in all JAK inhibitors combined with all data available in the literature for tofacitinib, ruxolitinib, and baricitinib, that the combined response rate in patchy alopecia is higher compared to alopecia totalis or universalis. Also, time to the initial regrowth is shorter. It's less than 2 months in patchy alopecia and less than 3 months in alopecia totalis and universalis. And also the time to full regrowth, it is approximately 6 or over 6 months for patchy alopecia and over 7 months for alopecia totalis or universalis. So to summarize, there is a tendency to better and faster response in patchy alopecia compared to alopecia totalis or universalis. But the good news is that many patients with alopecia totalis respond to this type of therapy. A modified version of ruxolitinib differs from the classic form by the fact that it has a longer half-life and higher bioavailability, but it still is an inhibitor of JAK1 and JAK2. It has shown a significant efficacy with the reduction of over 50% in SALT score. And just for those of you who are not familiar with the SALT score, to make it simplified, is the percentage of the scalp which is affected by the disease. So it shows the highest efficacy of 47% at the dose of 2.8 milligram. Some more ongoing trials with alopecia areata and the JAK inhibitors. Two new JAK inhibitors, one is a mainly JAK3 inhibitor and the other one is JAK1 and TYK2. And they both have shown efficacy. However, with the JAK1 and the TYK2 being more effective, with 53% of patients achieving a SALT score change of baseline 50% of or more. And what is interesting but not surprising is that patients who had a history of the disease of 3.5 years or shorter had a better response compared to patients who had a longer history of the disease. This is a case report which I found interesting. This is a patient who was treated with a JAK inhibitor for his alopecia totalis. And because this was a long-lasting disease of 12 years, this patient has meanwhile developed androgenetic alopecia. So in this patient, the regrowth was in a pattern of androgenetic alopecia. So we also have to take into consideration that alopecia totalis may coexist with other causes of hair loss, and we have to keep in mind that the treatment of alopecia areata does not always solve the problem of the patient. So to summarize this presentation about alopecia areata and JAK inhibitors, none of the JAK inhibitors are currently approved for alopecia areata, but I think that they are a very promising group. And what is interesting that probably the JAK inhibitors will be the first group of drugs which will be approved specifically for alopecia areata. So I believe in the years to come, we will have a very potent tool in our hands for the patients who are suffering from alopecia areata. And as mentioned before, I believe that we have to keep in mind that alopecia areata is a chronic disease, and we have to find a way for maintenance therapy for these patients who had a hair regrowth. Together with every person in the world who suffers from alopecia areata, I really hope that effective treatment for alopecia areata will be available soon. However, I am concerned that the cost of treatment will not make it accessible for everybody, especially in the first years of availability. With this, I would like to finish, and if you would like to hear more about hair diseases and about treatment in dermatological disorders, please consider subscribing to my channel. Thanks a lot. These are my potential conflicts of interest. However, all information in this presentation is based on peer-reviewed and official data.